Grace to you, peace from God our Father, from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Martin Luther used to say that you can't keep a bird from flying over you, but you certainly don't have to let him set a nest in your hair. Simply speaking, it means we're all tempted. None of us can avoid being tempted, but it doesn't mean that we have to fall into temptation and sin. So Lent seems to be a good time for us to talk about temptation, especially since all of our passages today deal with that topic, and in the coming weeks we'll see the same thing. So for the next 3 weeks we'll be doing a three-part study of this topic, temptation. Points that are going to be discussed is, why should we learn about temptation? How does the Bible talk about temptation? What's the source of temptations? Where do they come from? And how can we break this chain of events that takes us from temptation to sin? Today we're going to tackle those first two topics as we study James chapter 1, that we just heard read a few moments ago, but I'd like to reread it at this time. Blessed is the man who remains steadfast under trial, for when he has stood the test, he will receive the crown of life, which God has promised to those who love him. Let no one say when he is tempted, I'm being tempted by God. For God cannot be tempted with evil, and he himself tempts no one. But each person is tempted when he is lured and enticed by his own desire. Then desire, when it has conceived, gives birth to sin. And sin, when it is fully grown, brings forth death. Do not be deceived, my beloved brothers and sisters. Every good gift, every perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation or shadow due to change. Of his own will, he brought us forth by the word of truth, that we should be a kind of first fruits of his creatures. Why do we need to talk about temptation? You know, when Jesus spoke about temptation, he used the absolute strongest words that are recorded in scriptures. Listen to a few words from Jesus' Sermon on the Mount recorded in Matthew 5. If your right eye causes you to sin, gouge it out and throw it away. For it is better for you to lose a part of your body than for your whole body being thrown into hell. And if your right hand causes you to sin, cut it off, throw it away. It's better for you to lose one part of your body than for your whole body to go to hell. You know, Jesus was the most compassionate person who ever lived in this earth. The most loving. So why does he get so upset and use such scary, strong language when it talks about temptation? And there's really two reasons for this. First of all, look at what the stakes are. We're temporary creatures. We're only here for a short time. We think this is the whole thing there is, but it's just a tip of the iceberg. And so he wants us to not get sidetracked by the things that come on during our time here on earth. Look at how many people have lost sight of the big picture. They forget the truth that after death, there is eternity. Jesus wants us to know this critically important statement temptation can bring to us, sidetrack us from who we are and whose we are. So Jesus says that nothing compares to losing eternity. As difficult as it would be for you and I to go through life missing an eye or a hand, it's nothing compared to what temptation can lead us to in the loss of eternity. Eternity, you see, is forever. When you're working with mathematical problems and equations and you throw in infinity, it changes the total outcome and becomes oftentimes undefined. When we speak of our eternal lives, that same sort of thing happens. We don't quite know how to wrap our minds around forever. St. Paul talks about it in this way. Eye has not seen, nor ear has not heard, about the things when we talk about eternity. We have no idea. Our minds cannot understand the concept or the thought of eternity. And yet that's what awaits us by the gift and grace of God. We do not know that Jesus warns us about eternity in the strongest term because he doesn't want any of us to risk the possibility of not spending eternity with him, of living apart from him forever in hell. And so the first reason that we need to hear about temptation is because there's incredibly huge stakes and they will never end. So the second reason it's critical for us to understand temptation is when we deal with temptation, our freedom is at stake. We can become completely oblivious to the warnings of God's word during times of temptation and instead become bonds of sin. Ed Welch wrote a book titled Addictions, The Banquet in the Grave. He tells us that people can become wrapped up in sinful behavior that seems like fun to begin with, but it leads us to bondage and enslavement and death. The world offers things that seem very attractive at first, but they can become so dangerous to our eternal future. Look at the United States. We've been hearing how OxyContin has been used to help people through difficult times, but then they become addicted to it and end up losing, really, the value of their life. We need to address this issue. So we need to deal with this topic for two reasons. Because the stakes are incredibly high, and because temptation can lead to enslavement and sin. Okay, let's go to part two of our message today. This is the big question. What in the world is temptation? I think most of us would say temptation is when sin looks good, attractive, alluring. But that isn't the only way the scriptures talk about temptation. Another way scripture defines temptation is it's kind of a litmus test or a proof in the validation of our faith. In this sense, temptation is a way to determine the depth in which we trust in God. And there are a lot of places in the Bible that talk about this kind of temptation. Take, for example, Jesus was teaching a large crowd of people who had gathered, and it was getting to be mealtime. And Jesus noticed the people were getting hungry as well. And so he says to Philip, okay, Philip, what are we going to do about this? How are we going to feed these people? You're the treasurer. You got the bucks. And you know, Philip's response was, there's not hardly enough here to do anything with, but we do have a couple of fish and a couple of loaves of bread. Was Jesus really looking for Philip to go out and buy food for these people? Or was he looking for Philip to say to you, Lord, you know how to take care of this? You see, it was a test of faith, of the depth that Philip really trusted Jesus to be the Messiah, the long one they had waited for. Somehow, what God does to test faith is absolutely dramatic. Dave read the story from our opening passage today from Genesis. How could anyone, any father, even think about following that directive from God? And yet, that's just what Abraham did. He didn't even drag around and mope and say, God, think about this again. What are you asking me to do? But he immediately, the next day, got up, took the wood, his son, to give him back to God. Here was this son who came to Abraham and Sarah late in life, a promise from God. And now he was being asked to return him to God through a sacrifice. So what did Abraham do? Took him to Mount Moriah. And just as he was going to plunge the knife into his son, God intervened and gave a sacrifice that Abraham was happy to give to God. Abraham trusted God completely. What a question for us to ask. Do I have that kind of trust in God? You see, God didn't want Isaac as a sacrifice, but he wanted Abraham to realize how important following God was and is. And he wants us to realize that as well. When this kind of testing comes, it's not necessarily so God can figure out if you trust him or not. It's so you can see it yourself. Do I really trust God with absolutely everything? There's a 7th or 19th century mystic writer who has a question for us today. His name was A.W. Tozer, and I got a little behind here. His question was, God can't bless a man greatly until he has trusted him completely. I'm not so sure that God always uses that way to test our faith. I'm not so sure that he always operates the same way in every single person. I think God often entrusts people with more responsibility after they have stood the test of faith. And so we can view challenges in life as opportunities to follow Jesus, or they can sidetrack us in that process. We can view the tests that are going on around us to strengthen our faith. These tests could be subtle in how we use the opportunity of worship in our daily lives and the study of God's Word. They can become more pronounced in how we manage our resources that God has entrusted to us. For example, bringing gifts and offerings and using our time and talents and treasures for God. They can also be an opportunity for us to share the light of the glory of Christ, who's come into our hearts and lives to transform us and through us to share hope with people around us, people who mean so much to us that we can't help but speak of the things of God. The Bible also talks about temptation as an attempt to get believers to literally fall away from faith, to lose his or her relationship. And in this sense, temptation can be very dangerous. And the sin we are tempted to commit needs to be resisted. So Jesus talks about this when we read in James 1:12, "Blessed is the man who perseveres under trial, because when he has stood the test, he will receive the crown of life that God has promised to those who love him." There's so many examples of this type of temptation. Remember about David. He peeks over the fence to his neighbor's yard and sees his neighbor's wife, Bathsheba, taking a bath. And what things David then followed that up with as he fell deeply into temptation. Or when Jesus was in the Garden of Gethsemane, what did he say to his disciples? He told them, "Watch and pray so that you don't enter into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the body is weak." And what happened? They all fell asleep. How does this kind of temptation affect you and me? Hey, is there anything more important to you and to me than God himself? How would we respond to the test God put Abraham through? How does idolatry make subtle appearances even in our own lives? Have you ever heard someone use the Lord's name when something has gone wrong? Have we ever made excuses for not coming to church? After all, I've got a soccer game, or the Niners or 49ers are playing, or the A's or the Giants are playing. I got these tickets. I certainly don't want to lose them. Another way we think about temptation affects us to think about how we respond to the demands placed on us by the Ten Commandments. Respect authority, lusting, stealing, gossiping, telling half-truths about others, dying to have what our neighbors possess. Temptations are often a way that they come to us. Don't ever forget, the most important thing is God wants each and every one of us to triumph over temptation. He doesn't want us to fall headfirst into them. And he's promised us grace that when we do fall into them, he'll be with us. He has the promise of the crown of life awaiting for you and for me. He tells us that we don't face temptations that are unique and new. He says, rather, we've been tempted just as everyone else has been tempted, including his own son, Jesus Christ, when he was here on earth. And he promises that if we seek him, he'll provide a way out so we can stand up under them. There's also more. We are assured that Jesus, the one who withstood temptations perfectly, is present with us as we face our temptations. He is there to teach us, to lead us out of temptation. And should we fall, He's there to lift us out of the murk of sin through forgiveness. That's why He came. That's the very purpose for the cross and His victory over sin and death on our behalf. And so today, through the work of the Holy Spirit, He entrusts to each of us this gift of forgiveness. Not that we keep falling in, but rather that He shows us ways out. So how will each of these things work together? Well, in the coming weeks, that's what we're going to take a look at. Until then, be assured that God continues to lead us, guide us, and strengthen us through faith in His word and sacraments as we face the crosses, temptations, and trials of life with Him. Amen. Now may that peace that surpasses all human understanding keep our hearts and our minds in Christ Jesus, a life everlasting. Amen. And